Welcome to the 320 Podcast, where we encourage you to reach for the immeasurably more life with Christ. From discussions on scripture, to poetic messages, to dreaming big with Jesus, you will enjoy a variety of episodes brought to you by Shelly Wilson Ministries. To find out more about Shelly Wilson Ministries and the many resources available to you, please visit our website at www.shellywilsonministries.org.
Hey, you guys, it's Shelly. Welcome to this week's 320 Podcast. I'll apologize in advance. I'm actually homesick this week, so I'm going to have to do a few things here just to get through this podcast. Hopefully, you can understand my voice the way it is. But there is something I wanted to pull on a little bit of one of the writings God had given me this week. You may not be able to have the intro and the outro of the podcast today just because I'm not in the office where I can do all that. So, you know, we're just going to go with what I have in my hand at this moment, right? And so I want to talk about the writings that maybe some of y'all read, but maybe you didn't, called Sudden Endings. So let me read it to you. I'm trying to think of how this got stirred up in me. I think I was scrolling on Instagram and I know what it was. I was scrolling and I believe Henry Cloud was giving a message, and you know, he's the author of the book Boundaries that we cover. And I think he was talking about necessary endings, you know, and, I was kind of pondering that because it's such a hard topic, not for you guys who are in boundaries, but for everybody. Let's just be honest, you know, endings are hard, exits are hard, leaving is hard. And I think we're going to have to change our mindset. Certainly I've had to change my mindset, and I'm not going to promise you that it gets easier. Can I just be straight that I'm not promising you this gets easier? I am promising you that if we can trust Jesus in an ending, that we're still where we need to be, and wherever he's trying to get us, all we have to do is keep trusting Jesus. We don't have to fret. We don't have to stress. And I'm preaching to myself today as much as anybody. Clearly, I don't want to be sick in the bed. I have a lot of things I need to get done. But I am learning to rest in the moment, okay? And maybe that's just a word for somebody, that we need to learn to rest in the moment. Not every moment that we go through is expected, planned, on our calendar, or even wanted. But God is still, Jesus is the boss of me. I know some of you read that the other day, and you know, be so kind because be overjoyed when you hear me say that I'm actually designing a t-shirt with that on it as we speak. So I want to read this to you, and then I want to kind of dive into it a little bit more because I think maybe God wants to minister to some of you guys who are in these places. Okay. So it's called Sudden Endings. This is what it says. It says, many years ago, while working in the hospital in middle management, I had heard the rumors of pink slips going out. This meant there would be a fair amount of people being, quote, let go. I never dreamed it would be 91, give or take, of us all in middle management. It was a sudden ending. I was devastated and let go on my husband's birthday. Thankfully, there was a severance package to give us some time to regroup. Soon a friend called and I had an interview with a medical company and could work from home. This led to another company, eventually where I flourished under beautiful and family-like leaders, also working from home. Wow, who knew that sudden endings would be such a blessing? Likely I never would have left what had become familiar to me. It was steady and predictable, safe. Many years later, I would end up in a sudden closing of a ministry I'd poured all of my heart and all of my resources into. That closing had a lot of collateral damage that sent me into many years of counseling and questioning my own identity. Little did I know that it would be the end of my girls' ministry and the beginning of an unexpected and beautiful women's ministry. That sudden ending was actually a God-ordained expansion. But I sure didn't know it then. Without that sudden ending, I likely would have continued doing what I had always done, never knowing God had more for me. He was opening up a new and spacious place, something I never even dreamed of, a field I had not yet plowed, a land that would be assigned to me. The next years would prepare me for what I get to do today. I was embarking onto a new season. Every sudden ending has brought a soon coming door that opened something I could have never foreseen. I've never been good at leaving. I am very loyal. I hate exits, but they are necessary to follow Jesus. God has often had to pry my hands off of a thing so they could be opened for what He was about to pour into them. Maybe it's the same for you. Every time there was a sudden ending, there was also a grief, a bazillion unanswered questions, lots of pity parties, and many hot fudge Sundays while in a hot bath. And that, guys, is a true story. It's my therapy. But now that I can look back, I see that it had to be the way it was. Sometimes there must be a sudden ending or we would never pull that trigger. Because honestly, when God brings you into a new season, it's a little scary. And sometimes you'll want to just casually opt out and take the less risky route. Some of us would like to just stay happy-go-lucky right where we are. Am I right? Listen, do you really want to miss out on grand adventures with Christ? Miss out on exploring new lands and the new assignments He is giving you? Do you want to miss out on learning more about Him as you look upon new landscapes while feeling all the little butterflies of His new job for you? Oh my goodness, do not forfeit the glorious race out of fear. Gaze upon the beauty of watching Him do things you've not yet seen. You'll find your wonder of Jesus again like a kid in a candy store. And dear one, don't ever settle for comfort and familiar. They are destiny killers. And while you're at it, do keep your loyalty in divine check. Sometimes you must leave a place to get to a place. So don't overstay your welcome when God has pointed you to the door. If you've found yourself in a sudden ending, remember, God knows exactly what He is doing, and you, sweet friend, might just find yourself in an unimaginable, spacious place you never could have dreamed of. And sometimes, I've learned, what seems like a wreck is actually a rescue. Psalm 18:19. He brought me out to a spacious place. He rescued me because He delights in me. And when I looked up that word spacious, here's what it meant. Enlargement, either literally an open space, usually in a good sense, or figuratively meaning liberty. Y'all, that means freedom. Breadth, large, a large place, a large room. Now, isn't that amazing? He brought me out to a spacious place. That word spacious means to an enlarged place, to an open space, to a place of freedom, to a large room. So I want to dig into that a little bit because I think there's a lot of small lessons in that maybe we could talk about. I don't have this pre-planned. I don't have any notes. I'm just going to talk from my heart because, you know, most of what God gives me to write is personal, right? I don't know how to do this without using my personal experiences. Thank God that He uses the good, the bad, and the ugly to minister to the other people, right? That's where we now give compassion, where compassion has been given to us. It is true that many years ago, and this was really prior to my true conversion with the Lord, that I was let go at a hospital. We had been given, actually some of my patients in pulmonary rehab had heard the whispers about pink slips going out and they were concerned, but they had no idea and I had no idea that it would be me, right? We were in a position of thinking we were safe as middle managers. We had no idea what was coming. And I was obviously young, married, my daughter was young then. We did not have a lot of extra cash sitting around. you know, or a plan B. So I had just finished, I guess, my 4 years of school. I can't remember if I was getting my master's in business because I was able to do that through the hospital when I was there. So I must have already, I must have already gotten it is all I can remember. Yes, it would have to be that I'd already gotten it because I'm fixing to be let go. So here's the deal. So I get called into the office. I had just done a big project and saved the hospital a lot of money. You know, I had found some errors in their computing, and because of that, I found money, excuse me, for them. And here I am getting called into the VP's office, and they ask for my keys and my badge and let me know that I am being let go with 91 other managers. I was shocked. I was stunned. I was devastated. I start weeping right there because, you know, I just had no idea it was coming. No idea it was coming. They weren't allowed to tell me they were sorry. Legally, it's the craziest thing I've ever heard. I don't agree with secular ways of doing things. I think it's probably one reason God pulled me out of secular things, maybe in the business world. But so that was, you know, my first experience, and it was devastating. But here's the interesting thing, and remember, God is still ordering my steps. He knows what's coming in my life, what He's going to do with my life, where He's trying to get me to. But I still haven't converted, right? I think I'm saved, but I'm not at this point. And don't you know God's already working things out way back then? Because everything He formed in me is there waiting for its due time, its appointed time to show itself through Jesus. So I end up for only a year, another company, and that was medical sales. I was able to work from home. It was wonderful. And I remember thinking, wow, I mean, I don't have to do what I did. I never really loved the hospital job anyways, but it was a job and it was a steady paycheck. So, you know, I probably would have never left. I got paid on a regular basis. There was no real risk in it for me. You know, so it was like a burden was lifted that I didn't even know was a burden. You know what I'm saying? So after a year, I end up getting interviewed by a wonderful company through a friend of mine, hired with them, stayed for many years, come into the season where I literally lose my mind and I come to Christ. And right before their eyes and my eyes, I release an album for the Lord, and a lot of things begin to change for me. One thing I didn't share in this writing was that there was another sudden ending. I had felt for a while that I was becoming unsettled and restless at the job I had, and it was a wonderful job. I mean, it paid me lots of money. There was a lot of benefits. They paid for my cell phone. I think I've shared this with you guys before. I had wonderful relationships. You know, my boss was, I mean, the best boss anybody could ever have, a Jewish man who really was, you know, like a father figure to me, or a grandfather. And they were so supportive of what Jesus was doing in my life. But I asked God one day, is it time, you know, Lord, if I'm supposed to resign from this job, would you just use the word resign? And I turned on the radio. I think I've shared this with y'all before. And that day He said, I think it was Charles Stanley, and He said, some of y'all just need to resign your jobs. And I knew right then that it was time. I called my husband and I said, I think this is what God's saying. He's like, well, okay. And you know, but so there's a sudden ending, and there was a process where I had to share my faith with the people that I was leaving behind. But here's the thing. Even though it wasn't as sudden as the first job, which was more of a loss, it took a while for me to adjust because I went through a grief. I missed the people I left. I missed my boss. I missed the money. I missed the safety net of 401ks. I missed that they paid for my cell phone, my insurance. You know, there was just, I went through a lot. And so that sudden that sudden ending was what I would call the beginning of the real faith walk with Jesus. And I'm not saying you've got to lose all of that to have a good faith walk with Jesus. It was just my story that I would now have to depend wholly on Him, not because I had a job or other things. And so, but look, that sudden ending. The first sudden ending led me to wonderful jobs that I never would have thought I could have. That last job that I was telling you I just resigned from, it took me all over the country. I went on my first plane trip by myself. I learned how to navigate places where I was typically afraid to be alone. Learned how to go through San Francisco by myself, airports by myself, DFW by myself, Chicago, travel to Arkansas. There was just beautiful things that happened in my life that I never would have dreamed of when I was back at that hospital job. And none of that would have happened if there had not been a sudden ending. You understand what I'm saying? And so I'm to this place now where I'm having to trust God in finances, trust God with how do I do ministry with no money, right? How does that work? There's nothing you can do but trust Jesus. So when I get to the point in the writing that talks about, and many of you who come to me, you know this story well, right? Everything I to do today, I have to tell you, while God prepared me somewhat before 13 years ago, most of my preparation for what I do today happened 12 years ago, 13 years ago in November, because, you know, when something traumatic happens to you, you don't forget the date. I mean, I know the month of November for me, although it's my birthday, I haven't really celebrated my birthday in 12 years very well, because that month means more to me personally, and there's a lot of grief that came with that. But at the same time, I have to tell you, when I entered into, I knew that I heard God. I think I've shared with you guys, I took a small family inheritance that was given to me, and everything I personally had, and rented a building, and we started a ministry 1 year later, almost to the same month, we closed. I couldn't pay any bills. I could not handle a $40 water bill. There was no money. There wasn't just no money. There was no people. I mean, I think we had at the most 10 girls at a time, and it never really grew or anything like that. And there was a moment when my board of directors finally said, Shelly, they noticed it was weighing on my health. I was down to 90 pounds. I was having some personal things, personal griefs. I was having to deal with everything that could have gone wrong, went wrong. I've told y'all that before. So here's another sudden ending. It was a sudden ending of relationships that were precious to me. It was a sudden ending of a dream. It was a sudden ending of some other dreams of where I thought I would be with people in ministry, you know, in church life. And let me tell you, but here's the thing. It had to be the way it was. Because if God had never allowed the sudden ending, I'm telling you, I would still be running Drama Queens for the King. I would still be doing girls ministry, not just because that's what I thought I was called to do, and I was for a season, but because that's what everybody else thought I was called to do too. And no one could see past that, right? No one could see past that to the true gifts. I wasn't yet baptized in the Holy Spirit. The spiritual gifts were there, but they weren't activated in their fullness yet. So all of this is going on. And you understand there was so many things that had to happen. So the next, we've been open in our building 4 years, actually this month. I think I want to have a 5-year celebration next July, you know, to celebrate. 5 means favor. We've had the favor of God. I remember when God showed us this building, I was weeping in my closet going, I cannot do this. Lord, I cannot go through what I went through 12 years ago. It wasn't 12 years then. I can't do that again. I can't worry about a $40 water bill. The weight of all of that was too much. I can't do it. And when I knew it was him and I gave my yes, the adventure started and we never looked back. And I'm just saying that sudden closing of what I felt like was the dream. It wasn't the dream. Okay. Sometimes we settle our hearts on the dream when there are many dreams. God has many dreams and plans for our lives, but we think it's this one thing, and God has a sequence of things. That dream was beautiful and wonderful for the season it was in, but it had to come to an end so that God could prepare me. He had to prepare me to deliver prophetic words. He had to teach me about the prophetic. He had to baptize me in the Holy Ghost. He had to teach me about the gift of tongues and why to use those gifts. He had to teach me about inheritance of the saints. He had to teach me about women. He had to teach me about divorce. He had to teach me all of these things and reteach me. I had to unlearn. There was such a long process on the in-between of the sudden closure and then the opening of what we do today. I would be utterly foolish to say that I'll be in this place forever. I could be. I feel no sense of God shutting it down or closing it, but he's the boss of me, right? And so sorry guys, that noise you heard was my husband coming in at an unexpected time. And guess what? This is what happens when you're at home in the bed, sick, and you're trying to record a podcast. So welcome to the world, the real world of how things are never perfect in ministry, right? I hope you take notes so that when you step into ministry, that you are not falling into the trap of perfectionism or some celebrity mindset, or that you do what maybe I probably started out doing, wanted to give some air of perfection. I do love excellence, you know, and I'm sure I can edit that out of the audio, but I'm just not going to do it because this just is the way the week is this week. And I just really feel like I'm committed in this season to showing you the inner and the outer workings of ministry as they really are, not as what I would like them to be or whatever. So that's what that big ding was, you know. And my husband walked in and I said, well, you know, I was trying to record a podcast, and he just grinned and went, sorry. So that's what you get when you work from home, right? So anyways, here we go again. So guys, I wanted to talk about too, or just mention briefly, you know, where I say in the writing, I've never been good at leaving. I am very loyal. I hate exits, but they are necessary to follow Jesus. I've found this to be so true. I have never liked leaving. And I remember saying to a friend of mine one time, I said, and this has been many years ago before I went through some of what I've gone through, I said to her, I said, you know, I just feel like I'm always leaving. I'm always leaving and I'm never staying. And it wasn't that I wanted to leave. It's just that I would feel God's nudge. And I think part of that was my lack of understanding, and our lack of understanding of God's timelines, assignments, missions, and even the calling on our lives, right? I was reading in Acts. I finally finished reading through the book of Acts last night. And, you know, the last chapter talks about where Paul is shipwrecked on Malta. And then it comes to a place where it talks about that for 2 years, and it might have been that prior chapter, I can't remember right now, where for 2 years he was in a rental house, uncontested, and people came to him and he ministered to them for 2 years, right? When we look at the life of Paul, even the life of Jesus, they were always on the move. They didn't stay places forever. They were, their calling was to go here, there, and yonder as being led by the Holy Spirit. And I think for most of us in modern day times, we forget that. And we don't understand that in God's call on our lives, because He has set it in motion before the foundation of the world, He has put me in this generation, in this time, a dispensation for a certain thing and things that have been stored up for me to do right before I was born. And that I actually don't know the start of those things or the ending of those things. And so I've said before, I think a lot of my confusion early on with Jesus was I thought, well, I'm going to be here. I'm going to be a singer. I'm going to do it for the rest of my life. It's what God's called me to do. And all the same friends are going to be around me. And I'm going to have be at this same church forever. And guess what? It wasn't long before I started getting my heart broken again and again and again. Why? Because I didn't understand that things come and go, seasons come and go, places come and go, people come and go. And I always had a hard time leaving. But I'll tell you this, when God begins, when I left a place one time, and listen, just because you leave doesn't mean that something always went wrong. Let me be clear there, all right? So just when I say I left a place, doesn't mean something was always wrong. It just meant it was time to go, right? Sometimes there were things wrong, right? I walk in, God shows me what's wrong with the place. I speak the truth. People don't respond. That happens, right? Sometimes there's just a sweet fellowship and everything is going wonderful when God calls you away. Sometimes you've gotten all that you need to get from a place and you need to move on to the next place. And we don't like that because we like comfort. We like familiar. We like what has become safe. But once I got used to leaving, it got easier. Now, I will say, I have shared with a few friends, it felt like every time I left, a piece of my heart stayed behind, right? Because I love deeply. I fall in love with people. I fall in love with places. I'm that kind of person. And again, I'm very loyal, right? I'm very loyal. But I had to really face my loyalty issues because I realized in some seasons, my loyalty was to man and not to God. And I had to decide who was going to be on the throne, whether it was going to be people, whether it was going to be Shelly, or whether it was going to be Jesus, you know? And then I wrote in here, I hate exits. I do hate exits. I hate goodbyes because I know because of all the things I've been through and all the leaving I've had to do from time to time, everything does change. And so you begin to understand you already know what you're about to walk through, right? Your circle is going to change. Your environment's going to change. God's going to have to develop new relationships, new friendships, all of those kind of things, new alliances. But I have learned this. It is necessary to go when He says go. It is necessary to understand the same God that puts before you revelations, 3:20, I think it is, Revelation. The same God that says, I set before you an open door is the same God that shuts the doors. Listen, yes, sometimes free will comes into play and people can mess up in some ways the plans of God. In other words, God may put a plan in motion, but our free will just refuses, rebels, or people want their own ways and they can wreck the whole thing. But let me tell you, God will still get His plan fulfilled, all right? But even when people are involved, y'all, somebody needs to hear this because I had to hear this years ago. Even when people are involved, even when free will's involved, even when people's stupid decisions and choices wreck a thing that God started, let me tell you what, God still is the one who has the power to shut the door. Because I can promise you this, He could have corrected it all, but He doesn't force us to do anything, right? He lets us have free will. So the God who opens the doors is the same God that closes the doors. All right. So not everything is the devil. Can the devil hinder? Of course. We see Paul say, I tried to go here, but the Holy Spirit wouldn't permit us. Right. Or the enemy opposed us. So yeah, we can be opposed, but trust you me, God will still have His way in your life. He has already planned a redirection because He already knows what He's called you to do. none of this catches him by surprise. So you got to keep your loyalties in check, get good at leaving, and yes, you're going to grieve through every exit. Even when I've known God was calling me into a new place after a sudden ending, I had to think about that. Even when I knew he was calling me into a new place after a sudden ending, and it usually took me a while. There was usually a very long hallway between the ending and the open door. You know, or there were a lot of little open doors that I didn't know were part of the preparation because I was so focused on the big door, right? And now that I look back, I'm like, wow, I had to see what I saw. Even before we opened this building, this just comes to my mind, so I'll share it. Even before we opened the buildings, when Jan and I were running support groups, we had the healing group, Julie Lapelli was taking care of the grief group, and I had the Dream Big group. I opened my doors to my home to women with broken hearts, and I remember my living room being full. If that step had not been done first, I wouldn't have seen the need in time for a counselor. And because people were in my home and I began to hear people's heart cries and what the deep traumas and pains were, I knew I needed a counselor to help walk alongside to make sure that the people got what they needed to heal their hearts, okay? So it's the little things or the big things. Y'all know I say that all the time, okay? But here's the thing. If I do not allow the sudden endings... that's not even the right way I want to say that. I really want to position that more encouraging wise. So it says, let me go back to this phrase that I wrote. Every time there was a sudden ending, there was also grief. That's true. A bazillion unanswered questions and lots of pity parties with hot fudge sundaes in the bathtub. That's true. That's like my thing, one of my therapies. I have several these days. If you think that you need every question answered, you're going to get stuck. I promise you, because I wanted answers. Listen, I hurled every question at God every time a door closed, every time when I felt like I lost that ministry, when I felt like I lost my inner circle, when I felt like I lost my dignity, when I felt like I lost who I was for a long time. I couldn't even believe anymore what I had preached to young girls after all the pain. I think I've shared that with y'all. But listen, even all of that, all of the emotional baggage, all of the stuff I went through, all of the walks in the cemetery screaming at God, all of the walks in the cemetery throwing my phone, all of the walks in the cemetery where, you know, I asked, no telling how many questions. Why? How could you let this happen? I can't believe, is this a dream? I can't wake out, a nightmare I can't seem to wake up out of. You know, you have all of those questions, but there was a time. And listen, can I be honest with you guys that 12 years later, I still ask some of those questions when I've had a hard day, when the memories come back, you know. But here's the thing. I had to learn that I could still move forward with God, even though the questions weren't answered. Even though the questions weren't answered. I can't tell you how many times he brought me back to Joseph, Shelly. I don't even know if Joseph was able to clear his name. Do you have any idea how many times I've asked God to clear my name with people that misunderstood me and didn't give me a chance to rectify things, right? All of that was a part of what I would be doing today. Every single personal trial, personal emotion, personal trauma. Y'all know I've said this. I hate to be a broken record. It just is what it is. But this, because the sudden ending that catapults you into all of the stuff, the mental torment, the struggles, the questioning of whether you've made the right decisions, maybe the facing of the fact that you didn't make the right decision. Even sometimes God is so gracious to give us something we thought we wanted, so that we would realize it's actually not what we want. And that kind of was the thing with the ministry I had 12 years ago, I would have seen myself doing that for years. But the work was hard, and there were parts of me not being allowed to function in that particular work. In other words, I was so focused just on girls that I laid down the publications and I laid down the music, and the other parts of me where I think looking back, I was slowly dying inside. There were beautiful moments with the sweet girls that I loved, but there were other giftings in me that were not allowed to operate in that season. And that was what God, you know, that was one of the reasons, I believe, for the sudden ending, because there was still more in me. And that should be a place of encouragement. Sometimes God brings a sudden ending, not necessarily because things are bad, but because there just is more in you and more for you. More in you and more for you. And listen, I could have never thought or imagined what I would be doing today. It is far greater and more beautiful than I could have ever. It was never on my radar, never on my to-do list, never. Never, never, never. So I want you to think about those things. You got to be willing to move forward, even in grief, even with unanswered questions. And then ask the Lord, or sit before the Lord and say, you know, is there anywhere where you've actually given me what I wanted? But honestly, Lord, I don't really want it now. It's not working out like I thought it would. It doesn't look like what I thought it would look like. But maybe you needed to see how it was going to be. You know what I mean? I really had to go through that a few times, because God knew that my heart would never be at peace and would never be settled if he didn't allow me to walk the thing fully out, even when he knew it wasn't what I was going to ultimately want in the end, or give me the fulfillment, you understand, that I thought it was going to give me, you know. I talk at the end of the writing just about sudden endings. We would never pull the trigger. That's true. Most of my loyalties, when we get familiar with places and spaces, when we get comfortable in a place and space, it's harder for us to go to a new place, a new thing, new friends, new ministry, new focus, new assignment, new commitments, right? Some of us have commitment issues. Some of us, and I certainly have had those in my life, and it was mainly out of fear of failure, you know. But here's the beautiful thing about sudden endings, is they always lead to an adventure you never expected. You know, and I don't know where the little part came where I said, you know, you're going to feel all the little butterflies of the new job for you. It's true. Do you remember when you start a new job, or when you were in school and you went to a new grade, or you were in a new relationship with somebody, and there was always these little anxious butterflies? It's kind of like a mixture of anxiety and excitement, right? It's the same way when you're following Jesus. You're excited, but you're nervous, right? It's just our human nature. But he says perfect love casts out all fear, right? I mentioned that comfort and familiar are destiny killers. It sure is. I promise you that. There are a lot of people today who are quite comfortable where they are. They've chosen comfort, not because God meant them to stay there, but it's where they chose to stay, right? So he's only able to use them right where they are because they've refused to go outside the lines of what's comfortable. I can promise you, I would have never seen some of the glorious miracles I've seen if I've never stepped into things that were uncomfortable. And then I love the scripture, you know, at the end where he talks about this spacious place. I think it's so interesting when God says in this passage, which I think I talked about it briefly at the beginning, I didn't realize that the sudden ending was actually an enlargement, a promotion, if you will, an elevation in a healthy way, not a negative way, in a new level with Jesus, in a actually ended up being me carrying a new mantle. I was being mantled differently. He was pulling out some giftings in me that I didn't know were there, which was bringing me into an enlargement or an open space, a place of freedom. I love that where it says the word spacious is, it can be either literally as in an open space in a good sense or figuratively meaning liberty or freedom. I bet you've never considered that a sudden ending was bringing you freedom. And I could, when I think about this, because I know some of you that are listening to this podcast, you've had the sudden ending of a marriage, right? That you never expected. Yet some of you, I know now, because many of you came out of abusive marriages, you had no idea then. All you saw was the pain. All you saw was death. All you saw was the end. All you saw was the pain and the loss. But you had no idea that Psalm 18:19 was likely what God was doing, that he brought me out to a spacious place. He rescued me. Why? Not because he wanted me in pain or he wanted me to feel lost, but because he delighted in me, right? And he wanted to bring you guys into a place of freedom because you had lived in a place of oppression. And let me say this, it takes time to get used to freedom when all you've known is oppression. Hear me there. I just was talking to one of you guys on the phone this week about it takes time to get used to being well when you've spent years being sick. It takes the same length of time, if not longer, to learn how to be free when all you've ever known is bondage, or all you've ever known is oppression. Remember, I believe it was Joanne who said one time in class that where God was talking about Egypt, and we talked about how the Israelites wanted to go back to Egypt for crying out loud. They forgot all of the bad things, and they were fussing at Moses, and they just wanted to go back to Egypt. They were going to choose to go back to bondage, choose to go back to oppression, choose to go back to a place where there was no freedom, because they were now faced with something they weren't used to. It was unfamiliar. It was not comfortable. They weren't going to be fed the same way. You see what I'm saying? And that is very often what sudden endings brings us to. It's like I can see right now in my mind's eye, like someone is standing on the edge of a tall, tall, tall mountain cliff. That's what it feels like when there's a sudden ending and you don't know which way you're going and you don't know what God's doing, but you're on the edge of the cliff. Now, you can look at that as one of two ways. You can say, I'm on the edge of a cliff, and look at that from a negative perspective and feel like, you know, death is imminent. Or you can understand that you're on the edge of a cliff with Christ. And that eagles, do you know eagles mount up on the edge of cliffs very often? Why? Because when the wind thermal goes by, they pick the right one. Y'all have heard me say this in class. They wait for the perfect wind thermal and they mount up. And that wind thermal, or that Holy Spirit for us, carries us where he wants to take us. So when you come to the edge of the mountain cliff, it does not mean death is imminent. It may mean the death of a thing is imminent, the death of a season is imminent, but trust me that through death comes life, not just through salvation, but also through sudden endings. Through death comes life, right? And it's abundant life, guys. It's the newness of life. It's a new adventure. It's a new assignment. And without the sudden ending, some of us would stay too long in places that we do not need to stay any longer. So the God who opens the doors has to be the God who closes the doors. All right, so let me pray for you, Father. It's hard, God, on us as human beings to to go through sudden endings. We often don't understand. We often, God, get confused. We often get angry at you. We feel like we don't have what it takes to move forward. We question ourselves. We question other people. We question you. We don't know if it's the devil, if it's you, or if it's just us. But Lord, right now in Jesus' name, would you come into every sudden ending and show us what you're doing in the middle of this? Would you come into the moment of the sudden ending, God, and begin to give visual landscapes, wording around what you're doing? Would you take them to the scriptures that apply to their individual and unique lives, Lord? Wherever there is a sudden ending, God, I'm asking you to handle the grief, because you are the one who binds up broken hearts. You do it best. And that, Lord, you would just nudge along your little birds, God, so that they would continue to get out of the nest and to fly, fly, fly. I pray, God, that every comfort zone would be removed. Every place that we have made our bed, every place that we have pitched our tent that is less than what you have designed for us, I'm asking you, God, to remove it and to activate the adventure in Jesus' name. I command every spirit of fear, every spirit of anxiety, every spirit of depression, every spirit of hopelessness to go in Jesus' name. The devil is a liar. Lord, I thank you that your word is true and that all of our days were numbered for us before we were one day old. Jeremiah 29:11, we're quoting it often around here, God, that you have plans for us and an expected end. You know exactly what you're doing. I thank you, Lord, that I don't have to have the map in my hand, because the map is in your hand. Lord, help us to stand at the edge of the cliff like Moses did, and to lift our rod and trust that you're going to carry us, Lord. I speak to every fear that keeps you bound in Jesus' name. It's got to go. Jesus is faithful. Jesus is trustworthy. He will provide for you. He will care for you. He will tend to you. He will protect you, and he will walk with you through every moment. And God, we praise you for it. May every sudden ending walk us right into a flourishing season, Lord. And help us while we're in the hallway, God, understand that place will eventually open up to a spacious, broader, wide open space of freedom where we can operate just as who we are. Thank you that your word is true, Lord, that we can always stand on it. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, guys, I'll catch y'all next week.
We hope today's episode has blessed you and encouraged you to pursue Christ passionately. To join us again for more encouragement, equipping, and empowering, subscribe to the 320 Podcast. We would also like to invite you to enjoy our round-the-clock radio station, Royalty for Real Radio for Women, at royaltyforreal.com. That's royalty4real.com.